Hello, everybody. It's me, Kenneth, and I'm on the line here with Scott Mandelker. We have spoken to Scott before in our previous kind of podcast or show, and we spoke about the Law of One, extraterrestrials, and Eastern philosophy. And towards the end of that hour, we touched a little, I think, on the topic of wanderers. And we want to talk about the topic of wanderers today and go into that into detail. Just to describe, you know, first of all, what is a wanderer? What are some of the things that you can identify yourself, whether or not you are a wanderer? And obviously, most importantly, more clarity as to your life path or your mission if you are a wanderer. So, Scott, welcome.
Welcome. Thank you for having me again.
So, Scott, let's start with some definitions, because obviously that's important. What is a wanderer?
Well, the term wanderer, I believe, comes from a man who was a claimed ET contactee in the 50s, a guy named George Hunt Williamson. Mm-hmm. And there may even be a biblical reference to the term wanderer. It refers to what's commonly called an old soul. Hmm. And the idea is that there really is a ladder of sequential soul evolution. And so, you know, my second book, Universal Vision, is Soul Evolution and Cosmic Plan. You actually have to understand Cosmic Plan to understand soul evolution. And the wanderers on Earth are a facet of how soul evolution works according to Cosmic Plan. Mm. So Ruth Montgomery wrote a book, I think, called Aliens Among Us and Strangers Among Us also. Or Brad Steiger has done a lot of work on star people or starborn, which are synonyms. The phenomenon of walk-ins or other kinds, soul braid, all sorts of New Age terms are used.
Yeah.
Basically is a soul or being who in time and space has developed itself to a position beyond common human consciousness. Mm. Common or normal human consciousness is associated with third chakra. Third chakra in the seven chakra system of Indian philosophy, yoga, including it's in Buddhism, it's in Taoism, it's in some other Middle Eastern traditions. You know, the Abrahamic religions even have reference to chakras.
Yep.
Even in the Book of Revelation, there's a term, the seven seals. Yep. So the seven chakras are analogous, let's say, to the consciousness of seven dimensions. And yep. It's said in the raw material that the seven dimensions of any particular solar system, meaning much more than we can see in the physical, represent an octave. Octave, like in music, being a scale of vibratory frequencies, vibratory tones. So wanderers are those who are associated with fourth, fifth, and sixth density groups, ET groups, who are all benevolent, who would be normally associated with other planets in other solar systems in this galaxy. Mm-hmm. Normally, even this sector of the galaxy, meaning this portion of the Milky Way, those are groups that we're sometimes familiar with, like Sirius or Arcturus or Andromeda, Pleiades. And these are the names of stars associated with higher dimensional groups. Mm. Higher dimensional groups are those, in this case, who have already chosen what's called the path of service to other, meaning they're benevolent, meaning they seek greater development of love, wisdom, and unity. Unity consciousness.
Yeah.
And so they respect the law of free will. There is a law of free will. In Star Trek, it's called the Prime Directive. Hmm. Same thing. And it's basically respecting the law of karma. The law of free will is the creator's provision of freedom, actually, of course, of itself, to be what it wishes to be, to make free choice. Mm-hmm. And now, in the case of Earth and 3D physical conditions, you have lots of different souls, but you have certain particular directions or orientations of consciousness that need to be protected. So you have a lot of people who have no spiritual awareness. They need to be protected. There are those who are clearly service to self or negative. We call them Illuminati or those seeking one world domination.
Mm-hmm.
And they are the representatives of fourth density negative groupings associated with the Orion constitution or Orion constellation, which is basically the center of fourth density negative groups in this sector of the galaxy. Okay, so the Wanderers come here in respect of the law of free will. Therefore, in body and mind, they or we are as ordinary as anyone else. We can get sick and, you know, illness and all of that, plus mental problems, psychological distortion, which is, you know, the common condition here. So Ra says, Wanderers become completely the creature of 3D in body-mind, but in spirit, which is really associated with the head chakras, the higher centers 6 and 7, brow chakra, third eye, also crown chakra. This correlates to the spirit complex of body, mind, spirit. And of spirit complex, the wanderer retains their light. The light burns bright. The question is whether or not it's able to suffuse the mind and heart. And that depends on whether the person has cleared their blockages. So the wanderer is coming in respect to the law of free will. Are here for four primary purposes. And the first is basically planetary service, which is radiatory, invisible, energetic, subtle, and that's the intrinsic radiation of the energy of their own body-mind-spirit system, which is the triadic body-mind-spirit manifesting as the seven lights, the seven chakras. And the combined radiation of all of that is what's offered to the planet. To the extent that the wanderers are just here, actually, just their very being here allows radiation freely from the six and seven, but meaning the head chakras. And so there is some love light offered to the planet itself just by the wanderers being here, even if they're in a very damaged condition of mind.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, to the extent that the wanderer wakes up, not necessarily to being a wanderer, but to the value of love and wisdom, truth, and you know, benevolence to all.
Yeah.
To the extent that the wanderer realizes that, then the spirit is interpenetrating the mind and the body, and then the radiation improves. And so the first purpose of wanderers being here is to radiate love light to the planet. That would always be necessary or valuable. But at this time, based on the reality of the ongoing and imminent both dimensional shift, which is the transformation of planet Earth into its own next dimension or fourth dimensional condition, fourth dimension associated with fourth chakra, love, compassion, acceptance, you know, qualities of all New Age teaching that are true. The Earth moving into 4D actually requires or needs a certain energy boost or help or support for that, basically to prevent destructive Earth changes. This is a very interesting thing. Ra says these Earth changes, meaning volcanoes, earthquakes, crazy weather, flooding, all sorts of things, solar change, they're all signs of the time of the, you know, process of dimensional shift. And Ra says that this is, in fact, something you won't see anywhere else. They say that the primary cause of volcanism, meaning earthquakes and volcanoes and tectonic plate instability, is the release of thermal heat from the body of the Earth.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, of course. But that's associated with the planet's clearing of unusable heat in preparation for its energy body transformation. That energy body transformation is assisted by the wanderer's very incarnation, incarne, in the meat of the body. Now, the Earth changes are actually an inevitable, it's not God's punishment, it's an inevitable process. The result, the cause of that, all that unusable heat stored in the body of the Earth, is actually thousands of years of human disharmony, thousands of years of human internal conflict. Humans fighting each other and fighting themselves creates this unusable heat, which the Earth absorbs, which the Earth now needs to release. And so as to mitigate that release and spare the humans of destructive Earth changes, which were all predicted, you know, what's happened so far is far less than what was predicted 10, 20, 30, 50, 100 years ago.
Would you say this is almost like an analogy of a human body getting a fever?
Of course, it's the same. As above, so below. As without, so within.
Right.
Of course, it's exactly the same. And so a human person that is in the process of healing has often healing crisis. Hmm. Healing crisis is experienced as the release of disharmony from and through the body. And it can be very upsetting in the mind. That's also called spiritual emergence. And so that's planet Earth's dimensional shift is the spiritual emergence of the kingdom of heaven on Earth.
Hmm.
So the first purpose of one, that's just the first purpose. The first purpose is love, light, radiatory offering to the planet to assist its transformation and mitigate and reduce the destructive process associated with the venting, releasing of the unusable thermal heat in the body, which is the result of humans at war inside and out for the last 20,000 years. That's number one.
Scott, maybe just I want to go back to the definition of wanderers, and I'm looking at this passage from the Law of One, book number one. And I'm just going to read out this short paragraph, if you will. And the question is, who are wanderers? Where do they come from? And Ra goes on to say, I am Ra. Imagine, if you will, the sands of your shores. As countless as the grains of sand are the sources of intelligent infinity. When a social memory complex has achieved its complete understanding of its desire, it may conclude that its desire is service to others with the distortion towards reaching their hand. Figuratively, to any entities who call for aid, these entities whom you call the brothers and sisters of sorrow move towards this calling of sorrow. These entities are from all reaches of the infinite creation and are bound together by the desire to serve in this distortion. And this is exactly what you're saying, isn't it? That they are fourth, fifth, and sixth density souls who move towards a calling for help.
Yeah, these are souls from fourth and fifth and sixth dimensional positive other solar system planets or groups associated with love or light, wisdom, or the awareness of unity. Mm-hmm. Who are very keenly sensitive and aware of the suffering of humans on Earth and the value of offering help to itself. You see, there are junior ETs and there are elder ETs. In just the same way as in a temple, Buddhist temple, there are beginning monks, senior students, and the teacher, the master of the temple.
Mm-hmm.
And then there are visiting masters too. So, in the case of the elder ETs who are sixth density, like Ra and like some groups from Sirius, they are aware of the oneness of all life. They know that there's only self and other self. And that's the term Ra uses for other is other self.
Right.
Because they're aware of all being one. And that's actually the second purpose of wanderers being here is assistance to the suffering of people and animals and whoever else. It's direct physical service to those in need. Now, that term, the brothers and sisters of sorrow, is the term for wanderers. And wanderers, as well as ET groups, of course, higher dimensional positive beings, are all keenly aware of suffering. And so some people make an apology for what I consider negative ET contact of abduction, violation, trauma, and say, oh, well, those ETs, they don't know about fear. They don't know about your state of mind, or they think you should get with it, and if they can't wake you up gently, they wake you up roughly. This is complete untruth, actually. And positive ETs, like like awakened wanderers, are very sensitive to the suffering in the world. And so that's why, you know, wanderers are like strangers in a strange land.
Yeah.
And often feel, detached and alienated, literally alienated from the main culture, which is, in general, a culture that doesn't know how to love. And so the second purpose of wanderers being here is direct assistance to ameliorate the suffering, the sorrow of humanity.
Now, Scott, obviously, I wanna bring it to both of us, because I mean, certainly both of us are wanderers. Now, before we talk about that, I wanted to ask you quickly, what about negative wanderers? Is there such a thing?
There are, but there are very few, and there seem to be some on the planet now, but very few. They would be very top positions in the Illuminati, and generally. The reason there are few is because it's part of the law of free will, which is inviolable, which is freely respected by the positives and infringed or pushed as far, infringed as far as they can by the negatives. But part of cosmic plan requires that the wanderer from positive or negative higher dimensional groups experience the normal forgetting, which is the veil in mind in the 3D physical experience. That veil in mind doesn't exist when we go out of body, actually, but or after death, nor in higher dimensions. But in 3D physical, there's this veil, and so there's the conscious and unconscious mind, and the conscious mind knows very little compared to the total truth that we could know and that's available in the deep mind. So
why is there this veil, though?
Just a sec. The negative wanderer doesn't want to forget because maybe they'll forget that they're so evil and they might become positive. And that's very dangerous to them, that they will manifest less negativity than they wish. And so then they don't come wandering. Okay?
Oh, I see. Okay.
they don't want to lose their edge of violent service to self. And so it's dangerous for them. It's dangerous for the positive wanderer, who could become insane or negative or some kind of damaged mind condition also as a result of making what we call poor choices under the veil, being confused. As for the reason there's a veil, that was your question?
Yeah.
This is really deep cosmology or cosmogony. It's basically why is there... this experience of confusion in 3D. You know, Ra also says, called the law of free will, the law of confusion. This is the only source also that would equate that. The law of confusion is the right of all beings to remain in their confusion as a catalyst to get out of their confusion. And so, and this is the issue with disclosure and the positive ETs coming to save us. Is that it's an infringement of our right to remain confused until we ourselves strongly seek to get out of it. So the veil in mind in 3D physical only is basically established for a richer evolutionary experience for the One Infinite Creator. Before there was an octave, before a Big Bang, there was the mind of the Infinite Creator, right? Mm-hmm. Intelligent infinity. That mind of infinite totality knowing wished for a greater experience. And so it imagined there could be an experience of non-infinity or finity, the experience of itself, an experience of not being itself,
right.
Not being infinite. And so there thus was born the law of free will, or the realization that all beings should have their choice to be experience that the Creator itself should experience its confusion freely so as to move out of it and learn more of itself to experience diversity. And so in 3D, it was decided not at the beginning, actually, but later down the line of evolution, meaning trillions of years ago, but not from the beginning of the first Big Bang.
So would you say that's the end of second density?
No.
Or doesn't
no,
work
what
like
I
that?
Mean is No, no, no. What I'm saying is every galaxy starts from the center outwards.
Okay.
The stars closer to the center are older, historically and metaphysically, than those at the periphery. And so Earth is far out in the Milky Way galaxy and represents a later evolutionary development of the infinite. And so closer to the core of a galaxy are the older, the great Mahapurush, the great beings, the Logoi, who experimented with evolution without a veil in mind in 3D physical. It wasn't always there. And their experience was that souls didn't make much effort to get out of 3D. They were at the human level. They knew the score, but they didn't have a rich, vital, vivid experience because everybody was in paradise. Everybody was in all-knowing, all-love. And there was some kind of weakness in a desire for transformation. Mm. And so the desire for transformation is weak, was found to be weak. And then they played with it, and they developed the different types of veil in mind in the 3D apparatus, 3D physical. So if somebody says the negatives are veiling you from higher self, that's completely untrue.
Right.
It's the logos that instituted this veil in mind, or what we call the unconscious, in 3D physical, so as to provide greater catalyst, basically, for our own efforts at total self-development. And the veil is not needed in higher dimensions, because beings have already made their choices. And the wanderers come from planets that have already made the choice of service to other, meaning the social memory complex has determined clearly that they love love, and they love truth, and they want to help.
What is a logos?
Logos is a Greek term which means word. In the beginning was the logos, is in the New Testament, or in the Bible, Old Testament. Mm-hmm. In the beginning was the word, same as the Sanskrit om. Om as the sound of the creator, the primary creational sound, is the sound of the logos. And so the logos is a seven-dimensional octave of a solar system and planets. The heliosphere is akin to the envelope, or enclosing the totality of that octave, which is a seven-dimensional system created by the being whose most direct physical manifestation is the sun. So when Akhenaten and Amenhotep were worshipping Ra as the sun god or sun, it was really a recognition of the logos, which is the principle of unity, that all comes from the creator, and therefore all is the creator. I mean, the law of one books are based on the law of one, and people don't understand what the law of one is actually, and we don't spend enough time thinking about it. The law of one means that all is one. Okay, that's pretty simple. But it means that therefore time and space, self and other, causality itself is illusion, is illusory. There is no time and space from the level of the law of one.
Yeah.
And therefore higher self stands outside of time and space. From that perspective, it's understood that the veil in mind in 3D is a good training catalyst. It's like, what's the value of hard training versus no training? The one that gets some kind of training develops itself greater. And the one that gets none, takes it easy, which is fine, but it doesn't develop what it is.
Hmm. So it's almost like a diamond needs to be almost like sanded, or, treated with very hard material in order to become a diamond.
Yeah, yeah. Well, that's an analogy for the spiritual path. So alchemy, medieval alchemy in Europe, using the analogy of, the crucible in which alchemical transmutation occurs, is analogous to that, where there's sequential polishing of rough edges, which leads to purification within and without, and greater organization. The higher dimensional beings are energetically far more integrated and unified, body, mind, spirit, than we are. And Ra actually says that the adept, an example of which was Jesus or Yeshua, who was called a crystallized healer. The crystallized healer has no will, said Ra, meaning the healer is basically like the level of higher self, an adept or master, what do people use that term, a being who has cleared their personal blockages, who has developed significantly love, fourth ray, wisdom, fifth ray, balanced them, developed sixth ray, third eye, and is aware of oneness. The higher centers take on a crystalline appearance. They're sort of maximally structured for the incarnation. And then it's a question of just how much voltage they can carry. But the idea of crystallization or polishing is quite useful to understand the development of body, mind, spirit. And it's an alchemical process. And that's where you get into the seven chakras and the energy bodies and all that. But, you know, there has to be a unified approach where there's consideration of energy and consciousness both. People who do energy healing and that whole, all those New Age traditions basically have the idea that somebody can heal you by their transmission. This is not true. One has to be in a position ready to make radical change in mind.
Right.
For that kind of greater healing. And one can do it alone also.
Right. You can bring a horse to water, but you can't force him to drink.
Right, right. Something like that.
Well, okay, I mean, there's so many things running through my head now, but I think it'd be interesting to talk a little bit about Yeshua. So, was he almost like, literally a living, breathing, higher, you know, he had awoken to his higher self and he was performing whatever needed to be done. Like you said, he was literally the embodiment of his higher self. He had no ego left. Is that accurate to say?
It's moderately accurate and could be made more accurate. That's sort of the way Rob would say. First of all, I personally would never sign on to any use of the term ego, as you and I talked about another time.
Right.
So the view of Buddhism is that the sense of self is the result of limited perception of the elements of mind. The elements of consciousness are perceived as a solid, stable self, but that's a mistaken perception. And Ra said that ego, they also said, we find this concept, it's not a reality, we find this concept of ego unworkable and understanding cannot come from it, meaning the development of fourth chakra energy, love, understanding, cannot come from use of the word ego because there isn't an ego. So it doesn't mean there isn't a sense of self. It just means that there is no solid, the solid presence to it is formless and nothing near an ego. So there is presence, but ultimately it's the presence of awareness itself rather than a self or an ego.
Right.
Okay. So that's the first one. Personally, I actually wouldn't be able to say there was a Yeshua or Jesus. There are some views that he never existed and it's just the compilation of, you know, Egyptian Near Eastern mythology. And there's the travesty of the Council of Nicaea and whatever that was in a hodgepodging of religion from multiple sources and creating a Bible. There's an article called The Forged Bible, Tony Busby, I think. Forged Bible talks about the Council of Nicaea. And basically, much of the story of Jesus comes straight from Egyptian and other Middle Eastern religions and mythologies. So I personally can't say he existed. Ra doesn't say he didn't exist, but answers the questions that Don asks affirmatively, assuming, implying there was a physical Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
And he actually said that Jesus was a late fourth density wanderer who's now in fifth density. So that he's really a guy, but that he basically had contact with intelligent infinity or he had a full Kundalini awakening from a young age, and then, of course, needed much further training to be able to handle it and determine his path, which was positive. And so the idea is that he became an adept. He was an adept, which means somebody who's done the work of clearing 2 and 3, highly developing love and wisdom 4 and 5, working very well in the 6th center. So personally, from my understanding, I believe he knew that what he would do would create a new religion. And even though there were going to be all these troubles coming, which I'm sure he knew too, the value is the teaching of love and heart chakra related teachings. And so Ra said that Jesus knew that Earth was in the last portion of its 3D cycle. The last portion being the last 2,000 years of this 25,000-year major cycle, being the end of the 75,000-year master cycle. That's how they term it. And so 3D humans have existed on Earth as a native population only for 75,000 years after transfer from Mars, said Ra. So Yeshua knew that Earth was in the last part and there were only 2,000 years to go. And, you know, the primary teaching was about getting out of negative religion, which he perceived around him, and moving towards teachings of genuine love, love and compassion and care for all. And that was the key to the kingdom of heaven.
Yeah, so is there anything really special about, because I mean, I'm asking this and I'm going into this topic of Yeshua, you know, we're kind of wandering off from the topic of wanderers. But is there, why is Jesus and why is this Christ energy so dominant in a sense on planet Earth? Why is Jesus such a big figure?
Well, Jesus, you know, first of all, I don't know what you mean by the Christ energy, because a lot of New Age people use that term, but it's very unclear.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't use that ever.
Okay.
Because I don't know what it means.
Right.
But Jesus was a wanderer, according to Ra. He was a late 4D wanderer, positive, of course. And because of his awakening, was eligible to harvest into fifth density, positive. Now, in my personal view, I mean, I've lived in Buddhist temples and studied Buddhism and Hinduism and, you know, a bit of the Western ways too. It seems to me personally, Buddha was the world teacher for the East and Jesus was the world teacher for the West. And the Western races, the white races, are primarily intellectual, and the teaching that Jesus brought was basically teachings of love in different forms.
Mm-hmm.
Teaching that the Buddha gave to the peoples of the East or Asia, who are primarily intuitive and yin to the Western yang, or right brain to the Western left brain, the teachings the Buddha gave were actually how to get out of the whole octave, or how to return to unity and infinity. So the first step is enlightenment that leads to what the Buddhists call bodhisattva, busa in Chinese, bosatsu in Japanese. Bodhisattva means a being who's on the way to enlightenment. This is higher self. So the teachings of the Buddha are really for the East, for those who are more on the intuitive line, the mystic, who have some interest in returning to higher self now and getting out of the whole entire cycle of birth and death or the octave. Jesus, Yeshua, basically, I think, as teacher for the West, teaching love, which is the step up from, you know, third chakra, egotism, without an ego, but self-assertion and individuality of third chakra, because of the dominance of Western cultures, the national, you know, the hemispheric religion was brought too, meaning some modified version of Christianity, heavily distorted. But I think in some ways, Yeshua is a more appropriate teacher for humanity than the Buddha. Just in, I mean, I love the Buddha, and I, you know, have deep gratitude. But the teachings of Yeshua are closer to where humanity is, and closer to where humanity is going, and basically in harmony with the planet's transformation into fourth density, because he's talking about the teachings of fourth chakra. And that's another reason, I would say, for the popularity, whatever type of popularity of Christianity, any type, globally at the current time, because intuitively, everybody knows that Earth is moving into the higher dimension, and everybody knows, unconsciously, on deep mind, that their next step is fourth chakra.
That actually makes total sense to me. Now, let's just come back to your personal experiences, because obviously you are a wanderer. So when did you discover that you were a wanderer, and how did you know?
Well, in the 1980s, after I had done a number of years of pretty intensive Buddhist meditation in Thai Theravadan, Japanese Zen, Korean Zen, and a little Tibetan traditions, mainly Theravada, Vipassana, I had many out-of-body experiences. And one of them was actually a direct contact with beings that I recognized as my group. And I think I talked about this. This was at the Monroe Institute in the mid-80s.
Yeah, a little bit, I think, yeah.
Sync and all that. And, from years of meditation and looking at dreams and interpreting and also having had out-of-body experience, I feel I have some ability to know the difference between a fantasy, a psychological dream, and a genuine OBE. Out of body or astral journey. So I believe I can see that for myself and for some others. And this was basically me meditating on the tones of the the tape that was being played in that program. And I experienced a pretty strong energy transformation, and then I could clearly visualize, not that I was trying to visualize, but I was seeing what was happening, which was me rising through black space, and I felt it cold on my body, which was strange. And then I moved through what I felt to be a membrane, which was also strange. And on the other side, immediately, I found a semicircle of beings. They were presences. They were not of any particular body shape, and they were not even lights, but they were clearly defined presences, who were basically pouring out love. And it was joyous, and it was very touching. And at that time, I realized two things. There were two gnoses, Gnostic realizations or realizations of insight. You know, anybody can knock it down and say, oh, that's your psychological imagination. Sure, there's no physical proof. Mm-hmm. But my experience quite vividly was, number one, they know me far better than I know myself. It's not like, oh my God, I'm not alone. Oh my God, it's my family. Not at all. It was really, wow. They really know me far better than I know me. And the second is that, you know, I know myself a tiny, tiny portion of what I am. And that's really the case for everybody. It's just that we normally don't realize it. So I realized that, no, I knew that was my group. That was all. And then it was certified that to me, that I'm a wanderer. And of course, it also puts many, many things into context or into understandable form, like, you know, a sensitivity to human negativity. You know, this is a planet full of negativity, if you haven't noticed. And lots of wanderers are very unhappy about it and don't realize why they walk around unhappy.
Yeah.
But, you know, to walk around in a civilization that has so much aggression and anonymity, distraction, and sleep. the three primary qualities of humanity, as well as dishonesty. Ra said, talked about honesty, of which your peoples have a paucity, P-A-U-C-I-T-Y. Paucity means a poverty. Mm. So the poverty of honesty of Earth humans. This is really true.
Yeah.
And a penchant for aggression inside and out and conflict.
Yeah, I'm just reminded of the quote by Krishnamurti. Painful. Sorry, go on.
Sure. No. I'm just saying, wanderers commonly are not happy campers.
Yeah.
And many have psychological problems, which doesn't mean they're not wanderers. It just means they have psychological problems. So does everybody, right?
Yeah.
Look at the leaders. So the difference is that the wanderer has a treasure within, and it's only when they open their heart deeply that they'll find it. And the negatives have no access to that.
Yeah, I'm just reminded of the quote by Krishnamurti that says, "It is no measure of health to be well adjusted to a profoundly sick society," and that's something that really deeply resonates with me.
Yes, it's a deeply sick society.
Yeah,
deeply. And, you know, one reason that wanderers are here is because Earth humans cannot take care of themselves nor their planet. Now, negatives would say that too, and they'll say, therefore, you know, we're going to destroy and conquer. But positives say, therefore, we will protect you even while you keep, you know, shooting yourself in the foot. And so there are limits to negative intervention on Earth. And there's protection all over the place available. But in general, yeah, society is very distorted. And wanderers often feel a deep sorrow at being here.
Yeah.
And sometimes end up with psychological conditions, psychological conflict, based on a direct receiving of the suffering and anger of Earth humanity. It's you know, it's hard to walk around in a planet of anger or conflict or misunderstanding with a very big, sensitive, open heart. Of course.
Yeah.
And that's why love is not enough. Love must be coupled with wisdom. Just as Yeshua said, as clever as snake, as harmless as dove. Harmless as dove is the fourth ray love development. Clever as snake is the fifth ray wisdom development, which really means discernment. Discernment and honesty.
Yeah.
Commitment and honesty.
Yeah, I think that's a great point, actually. I think there is this almost like an anti-intellectual vibe with the New Age movement. You know, they identify with love so much that they lose this sense to the ability to think clearly and to accept information without emotionality.
Right. Yeah. True. Yeah, well, you know, love without wisdom is one step higher than no love at all. So, you know, third chakra consciousness, which really could be called ego, even though it's a false belief, or it's a belief in something that doesn't exist, the egotism of common humanity is itself a blockage of love. And that's the main problem here. So that itself makes all sorts of troubles.
Yeah. Now, Scott, there might be some people out there who are listening to all of this, and they're thinking, okay, so you've made this almost like quite a firm distinction between people who are wanderers and people who are not wanderers. And then, you know, they're going to say, okay, this leads to a concept of separation. Suddenly you've got people who are more spiritually advanced and some people who are less spiritually advanced. And, you know, that creates further division, which is not spiritual. What would you say to that?
Well, is there a difference between Robert Kennedy and Adolf Hitler? Of course there is. What a stupid question. What's the difference? Well, one difference is that Robert Kennedy, for all intents and purposes, as well as I can see, was a man of love and justice. And Adolf Hitler was a man of, extreme desire for control. So that's a difference, right? But nobody's talking about good or bad. I didn't say it. I just said there's a difference in their orientation of consciousness. Now, does that mean there's a separation? Is there elitism there? Is there judgment there? No, I didn't put that in. Is there a difference, is there a difference between the Buddha and a beginning student? Yeah, of course there is. Is there separation? I don't know. They're not two different bodies. There are different consciousness streams. Yeah, there are different consciousness streams there, and therefore one is called a Buddha and one is called a beginning student. No, yeah. Of course. So what's the difference? One has developed itself profoundly and the other has not. One has developed all seven rays fully, or at least love, wisdom, and the powers of unity fully, and the other hasn't. Is there separation? I don't know. Is that elitism? No. There's just a distinction in time and space between levels of development. And this is another fallacy and folly of the love over wisdom New Age community, which is that since everything is one, it's bad to talk about more or less development. It's bad, and it's not true. Everybody's one, everything's the same. Well, that's not true at all.
Yeah.
Clearly, Adolf Hitler and Bobby Kennedy are not on the same page. And clearly, the Buddha is more developed than the guy who comes there and doesn't know anything. Clearly, this is in time and space. At the essential level, all is one. Sure, it's just one ocean of light consciousness. Sure, of course. But here, in time and space, the relative view, yes, indeed, there are levels of development of particular qualities of the being. Mainly, fourth, fifth, and sixth chakras. That's all you need to think about. That's all. It's not there's anything else happening other than the seven chakras, which manifest as body, mind, spirit. That's it. And so the Buddha is a guy who's developed four, five, and six fully. That's it. And he's totally clear in two and three. One and seven are all fully coordinated. And that's the end of that. And the guy who comes who doesn't know anything hasn't done it. No? Am I elitist? Is there separation here? All that extra talk is useless, I think. Clearly, there is distinction in orientation of consciousness. Clearly, there are what we can call levels of development. There's a, there's an initiator and there's the initiatee. There's the guy to get initiated and there's the guy who got initiated. I'm talking about the positive path. So there's a teacher and there's a student.
Yeah.
No, of course. So that kind of thing, is useless, that kind of talking, and it's wrong. It's basically an artifact of love without wisdom. Mm-hmm. Because, yes, all is one. And yes, here in time and space, there can be determined levels of particular qualities of development, levels of development of particular qualities of our being. Of course.
Do you want to talk a little about the Illuminati? Because we've mentioned that maybe two or three times, but we haven't really talked about it properly. We don't have to get into the details of it, but just to...
Sure.
Couple
yeah,
sentences.
I'm just going to keep it in general.
Yes.
This is 3D. So, in 3D... according to cosmic plan, souls are veiled and souls have free will. Therefore, some will go positive and some will go negative. Now, I don't mean good and bad, but I do mean a polarity that can be understood as positive negative, right? There's electricity and there's magnetism. One is called the positive pole, the other is called the negative pole, but it's all one. So I'm not saying good or bad, and I'm not creating separation.
Yeah.
But in time and space, some souls in 3D go positive, some go negative. The majority of souls in 3D go positive, meaning they value love and goodness because it feels right, It feels good to be kind to each other, and it feels right to see the truth and live our lives from it rather than deceiving ourselves and deceiving others.
Mm.
But down here on the ground, there is basically, you see, Earth is in some ways like a correctional institute for this sector of the galaxy.
Right.
In every sector of the galaxy, you have multiple 3D planets. Sector, mm-hmm. how big that is, I have no idea. But in any sector or portion of a galaxy, you have multiple 3D planets. When they asked, Don asked Ra about how many planets in the galaxy are inhabited, Ra said, you know, which dimension do you want to know about? And Don went from 3 to 6, and the numbers were in the millions for each. Millions of third, millions of fourth and fifth and sixth dimensional planets in just this galaxy. Millions at each level. So then, in this sector of the galaxy, there are many. How many? I don't know. And then, on all those planets, there's the normal evolutionary progression, which means the planet goes from first to seventh dimension in its own time. Not every planet does that, but some planets do. The planets that are in third density are on their way to four. When they go into fourth density, not everybody graduates. Those who don't are called 3D repeaters. They repeat the density. Not by punishment, but by necessity. It's the higher self choice. It's their choice. They're not being forced, but there's no other way. Because if you didn't go to step A, you can't go to step B, because you can't get to B without going to A. You know, none get to the Father except through the Son. None get to the higher self except through heart chakra. That's what he meant. So none get to fourth density without development of the qualities of heart chakra and of self and mind and being needed to get into fourth density, obviously, which means, oh, the meek shall inherit the earth. And those, which really means loving and humble and caring and goodly, they will inherit the earth. That's the case on every 3D planet that's going into 4D positive, but not everybody fits the bill. Not everybody is sufficiently self-developed for that graduation. And then in this sector of the galaxy, those who missed the boat on other 3D planets are sent here. So Earth is a collection of souls who are chronically non-evolving, chronic repeaters, sleepers, sheeple, whatever you want to call, basically people who are really not taking good care of themselves. They don't know how to take really good care of themselves. Therefore, they're not self-loving, and they're not deeply self-honest. Therefore, they create a world without love, without honesty, or a social structure that way. One that's given to war and one that's given to deception. The Illuminati are basically attracted. You see, the Illuminati represent a portion, a small portion, really, of those 3D repeaters from the multiple planets in the sector of 3D who went to 4D, of the souls who didn't graduate, come in here. They're the portion of that 3D repeater collective, those who are sleeping, which are seeking service to self. And they have ties to negative ETs, of course. And then there's the whole bloodline thing, and they trace themselves back to King Solomon and all of that, Babylon. They can't go further than that, I guess. They go to Atlantis, I would imagine. But they are simply those who are choosing the path of service to self. Now they have alliances with 4D negative. In fact, they probably had it for thousands of years since, you know, Babylon. Since the Egyptian priests overran the temples of Ra set up by Akhenaten. Basically, Akhenaten was trying to bring his society back into appreciation of the one glorious creation of love, light. And the priests were already committed to negative action and service to self at that time. And they basically, I believe, they killed his wife. And he went insane, and then destroyed all of them, and the war was on. But Orion has been here for a long time, and in the timeline, Ra talks about how Moses was an extremely positive being. And initially, the Hebrews' contact with Yahweh, which is a positive ET group, Yahweh was deemed a positive ET Confederation group, probably 6D, by Ra, and that Moses was in touch with Yahweh. But then after some time, based on the pressures of his people for specific action, like how can we be the dominant group here, the contact with the true Yahweh was lost, and it was replaced by Orion negative 4D that said, I am Yahweh, and I'm the jealous, angry God, and I'll kill my enemies, and you're the chosen people, and on and on and on. So the Gnostics understood that a bit. So Ra, not me, Ra, said that the Orion, they said basically major inroads were established in the Middle East about 3,500 years ago by the notion of holy war. Not chosen people exactly, but holy war. And every group around the world has picked up on that and encouraged by Orion to pick up on that, the notion of holy war, which is basically a pseudo-sanctification of violence and dominance. And the negative view, the negative group basically believes that it's holy and that they're doing holy war. So that's considered a primary distortion that has allowed Orion to make major inroads here. The other thing that's interesting, though, is, and I wrote about this in an essay called Human Crisis and Divine Plan, is that, psychologically speaking, there's a particular interesting correlation between the service to self, Illuminati, and the 3D human majority of repeaters or non-seekers. Within the shadow of each collective group is the other. The reason that we have negative power structure on Earth, or Orion has made such inroads, is that those who are not yet negatively polarized or positive, those who are unclear about the difference between good and evil, or love and control, they participate in love, they participate in control, and they therefore never harvest or never get out of 3D. But within their shadow is to some extent a desire for power and domination, and that's why they keep the system running. Because it's not really, I remember I realized this at one point, it's not really, the fact that the people on the bottom are feeling oppressed, for most of them, isn't the problem. Or the problem is not, the problem is that the way they understand their oppression is not that the system is corrupt or negative. It's that they're in the wrong place. And if everything, if they were just on the top, everything would be okay.
Right, so I see.
They keep the system in place by being trampled underfoot. Meanwhile, and within them is some, often, not always, but often, some desire to be, you know, king and queen, to be, to gain fame and fortune at any cost by power and domination. Within the negatives, too, is the shadow of the unpolarized, or those who, that group I just spoke about, not positive or negative. Because the negatives here are also unharvestable, and they're not negative enough. They're not evil enough. They're not ruthless enough. They're not. They you know, most of them try to be kindly to some, they're in group, and they're, you know, brutal and sadistic and manipulative of everybody else. But actually, that doesn't cut it. You know, you have to actually blot out the heart chakra fully to harvest 4D negative. And so they themselves are inadequately negative, just as the unpolarized are inadequately polarized. They're not actually clear about what's your value, love or control, and good for all or only good for you. And so these two groups are here. And, you know, it's part of the way of evolution. It's called bundling, in my view.
Do you want to mention? Do you want to just mention the ratios of 95% and 5% and 51% and 49%?
Sure. Well, again, in the Law of One, when Ra was talking about the requirements for harvestability into 4D, for service to other, positive path of love and unity, the soul needs to be 51% service to other. 51% service to other doesn't mean you're 51% of the time asking, how can I help? Can I help? Can I help? It's actually 51% of the time the person is being honest and kind to themselves and to others. And 49% of the time, they're blocked and selfish and confused. So it's not actually a big deal, you know. 51%, you know, having some moderate commitment to virtue and benefit to all is not such a big deal, but very few can do it.
Yeah.
On the other side, service to self for D negative graduation requirements would be or are, as Ross said, 95% service to self, which is the same as 5% service to other, which is interesting. So 5% service to other really means 5% heart chakra open. Is as difficult as 51% heart open. Now, it seems to me that 51% heart open is kind of easy, but there is some favoring of the positive path for the logos. The positive path, you know, because it's a creation of infinite love and unity. So those who are seeking love and unity, which is truth, are in harmony with the way of creation. And those who are seeking service to self, power over others by manipulation and domination, can only do that by a massive avoidance of truth, a massive continuing and further blockage of the reality that all is one, which is accessed by heart chakra. All is one is known in the sixth chakra. Heart chakra is open heart, or you know, the way of receiving and unconditional acceptance. So that those numbers there really are just referring to what's easy or hard in the requirements for 4D graduation. The point that I take away, one of them, is that very few of these Illuminati are going to graduate to 4D negative. And it's becoming very clear to me now, as time goes on, that the Illuminati are the slaves of 4D negative. They don't know it. They're the slaves of 4D negative. And they've made a deal with the devil. And you see, the devil is the devil, or the guy on top is on top, because he doesn't make deals, he'll lose. He doesn't make a bet, he'll lose. He only makes winning bets. You don't make winning, you don't make dubious bets. You didn't get to be on the top by making bad bets. So these Illuminati will basically then go to the next 3D planet after the Earth moves into 4D positive. This is called the three-way split. The three-way split is what happens after dimensional shift. In that, those who are qualified by love and sincerity and goodliness will remain on the Earth and become the kingdom of heaven, the kingdom of heaven on Earth, or the meek inheriting the Earth. This is, these are, you know, indigo children, crystal children, those terms, which are basically fourth density positive wanderers, generally their first lifetime, who will inherit the Earth and take over the new civilization in which there won't be war and disease. There'll only be, you know, goodness and greater seeking of truth. That's one split, which is those who will remain here in the new love-based world.
And when is this scheduled to happen?
Well, let me check my watch just a minute.
Because I can't wait.
wait, tick, tick, tick. Oh my God, where's my battery? My battery's wrong. Wait a minute. Wait. Duracell.
It's more of a calendar, not your watch, I think.
Okay. You ever see that cartoon? There's a very cute cartoon of two Mayans. And one guy has the big stone, and he's got a chisel in his hand.
Yeah, I saw.
You know that one?
Yeah.
Said, well, I'm sorry, the calendar only went up to 2012. The other guy says something like, well, that'll be a real hoot for them, won't it?
Yeah. That'll really freak somebody out someday, I think.
Yeah, in previous times, I had said, I think, 2010, 2012, 2013. Obviously, that's not right. I really can't say now, but Ra gave a prediction that in 1981, in January, it was like January 4 or 20 or something. So January 1981, Ra answered the question, how long will the Earth changes last and then what? Don asked something like that. And Ross said the earth changes will continue unabated for approximately 30 years. Okay, that means approximately 2014. What does the word approximately mean? I said 10%, plus or minus 10%. That's plus or minus 3. So 2011 plus 3 is 2014. I'm sorry, 2011. It's actually, they said it in 1981. That becomes 2011 plus or minus 3. Add 3,
yeah.
Becomes 2014.
Mm-hmm.
So my current thinking is I'll be surprised if we don't have dimensional shift by the end of 2014.
Right. So why do you say it can't happen before 2013 or 20, like maybe by the end of this year? Do you don't see that happening?
Oh, it can happen any moment. Absolutely. Any moment. So it'll be in the flash of a light. It'll be, you know, you see, all development is gradual, but the majority of development is invisible. Mm-hmm. It's only the visibility that gives rise to our idea that it's instantaneous. Meaning, the changes of Earth energy are continuous. When it reaches a certain point, then there's manifestation and the complete end of 3D. So Ra said, at the end of this approximately 30-year period, which is approximately 2011, the Earth changes will be significantly abated, and then fourth density will begin. Now, there's a lot of discussion in community or circles of people who read all this and think about it. Will it be gradual? Will it be instantaneous? Mm-hmm. Will there just be multi-generational incarnation of 4D souls who just dismantle the negative structures and negatively oriented souls are no longer born here? And Ra did say that there is a several hundred, many hundred year process to certain aspects of the change.
Mm-hmm.
So when Ra says, yes, after that it'll be fourth density, that doesn't necessarily mean the 3D culture will disappear, but it could. Personally, I think that's how it'll happen, that there'll be a big flash of light and most people will end up on the astral plane, and some few will ride it through because they have the body, and that'll be the remnant, but the remnant will be in Paradise Earth, not Wasteland Earth. And Paradise Earth is the fourth density sphere, which is preparing now. So that's what's happening.
What about this thing about the alignment of the galactic center?
Yeah, John Major Jenkins, who I like a lot, who was one of the additional speakers on the Time Global Shift seminar tour that I directed in the early 2000s, which included also David Wilcock, has, you know, the view of my, you know, galactic alignment 2012. Personally, I'm sure that that this dimensional shift is related to the movement of the solar system around galactic center. Ra talks about that, and it also fits the typical initiatory pattern. So Ra said that because the galaxy could be understood as a clock face. And so the rotation of the spiral arm of the Milky Way, in which planet Earth is, has moved us into a different energetic condition of time and space, a different energy dynamic, which is not the same as the age of Aquarius, not, because it's not a 2,000-year cycle. That's another cycle, but it's a cycle within the greater orbit of this spiral arm around galactic center.
Mm-hmm.
So I can sign on to the idea that based on the movement of this spiral arm and thus our solar system and Earth, we're exposed to a different energetic condition. And other scientists have said this. And because of that, there is greater alignment with galactic center. And that is at the heart of, actually, dimensional shift in some ways. Because the initiatory pattern is that the aspirant or disciple is presented by his teacher to the Grand Initiator. The Grand Initiator is the Galactic Logos.
Hmm.
Galactic Logos is the central spiritual sun, the big banger, the guy who banged all the other bangs. So before there was stars, there was the galactic center, which right. came out of nothingness or void, the intelligent infinity. And so the galactic center is in many ways the core, the key initiator of all the logoi within the galaxy, meaning all the stars and their being. You know, stars are beings. Star is a guy. It's a being. Everything is all conscious, right? All energy is conscious. Mm-hmm. So there's the consciousness of a star, and there's that's the logoic consciousness, the creator. Mm-hmm. And so the creator or the logos of the solar system is in closer relationship now to galactic center.
Right.
So the core initiator is galactic center. Mediator is the logos or the sun, the solar being. And the receiver is planet Earth. And the result of it will be the initiation of planet Earth, which I do believe will happen in the twinkling of an eye. And I do believe the whole thing will disappear in a moment. But I don't know when, and I don't know everything.
So would it almost be like, you know, I keep thinking about the analogy of enlightenment, that it's almost as if you... it happens suddenly after it's like boiling water, isn't it? Like you boil water, it goes up.
Yeah,
always. Right, and then it suddenly changes into steam.
Yeah, yeah. The analogy that I like to use is the orbital shell quantum leap of electrons orbiting a nucleus. So that, you know, you put energy into that atom and the electrons spin faster. And at a certain point, they move to a higher orbital level. Now, maybe my physics is wrong, but that's what I think. And the result of, you know, long, gradual, energetic upgrade is instantaneous quantum shifting.
Right.
And I expect that. And we're talking about fourth dimension, not fifth dimension. We're talking about fourth chakra, not fifth chakra.
Right.
Because in this scheme, the astral plane, which is what the New Age people say is the fourth dimension, is the third dimension, according to Ra, which is that every dimension from 3 through 6 has an incarnate and a disincarnate phase. And so there's the portion of being in body, which is called space-time. There's the portion of the density that's called time-space, which is non-physical. And so the astral plane, heaven worlds, all that is time-space, 3D time-space. And fourth density is a whole other story. Hmm. And Earth is moving into the dimension associated with heart chakra. No. Dimension associated with wisdom? I don't think so. Not fifth, because people don't even know love. They can't even love each other. Look at the New Age groups. They're fighting too. Disagreement is not fighting, but people are fighting. And also, you know, scandalous leaders. So, if you don't know love, you won't be getting into wisdom anytime soon. So, yes, that dimensional shift is, I believe, imminent, and also is the visible precipitation of long, steady, unrecognized development, which is the energy development of Earth's fourth 4D body, energy field.
Now, the Law of One obviously refers to the negative 4D groups as the Orion group. Is that the same as the reptilians?
I believe so. Ra never uses the word reptilian.
Yeah.
I believe. I don't even know if they use the word gray or anything like that. You know, this is in the 80s, and those terms were not so common.
Mm-hmm.
But, no, they didn't say anything about it. In my view, personally, yes, sure. The representatives of 4D negative Orion that are on the Earth, in the Earth, around the Earth, and working closely with the Illuminati, certain portions of the Illuminati, are reptilian and sauroid, S-A-U-R, and the Greys are some subsidiary or allied group with them.
Mm.
I think that's quite real.
Now, Is there a fifth density negative group that's controlling these guys?
Yes and no. Ra said, and we can explain, I'll unpack it, that there are very few Orion Federation members in fifth density negative. Now, normally you would think the higher controls the lower.
Yeah.
Ross said that the reason for that is that when the service to self soul in upper 4D negative, moving into 5D negative, continues, particularly as they get into fifth density, Ross said, they no longer find any value in other selves. Meaning,
I see.
They don't continue their polarization or their development of power by controlling others. They no longer find that that's useful or helpful because they've maximally developed it. They can do whatever they want to other. What they really need now is complete domination and manipulation of mind and consciousness. And so they become hermetic, and they're all top-level black magicians. But they no longer even want to deal with others because others are seen as an illusion, and that the engagement with the apparent other is diminution of their power. And that's very similar to the positive path, higher level, in that like 5D or certain periods of advanced meditation, or guys who are pretty well developed before they break through, in that the spiritual practice is quite solitary. And they're not interested in being teachers. They're interested in finishing the work. And so, unfortunately, that leaves the field more open for those who are love without wisdom on the positive path.
That's okay. So do you want to just talk about what happens at 6D then, with, you know, the merger of the 5D and the positive and negative paths?
Well, the end of the two paths occurs in early sixth density, not fifth density.
Mm-hmm.
So there is late 5D negative, there is late 5D positive, there probably or is very, very early 6D negative. But I imagine by the second phase, the second of the seven subplanes, 6.2 or 4, maybe 6.4, I don't know, one of those levels in the early portion of sixth density, the negatively oriented entity, who's no longer part of any group, realizes they can't go further holding this view of separation or difference. They can't actually continue with the idea that they exist as a separate entity from the mind they're manipulating. The mind, they're totally isolated or they're totally solitary, right? So their work is wholly in dialogue with their invisible teachers. But at a certain point, there's no more teacher because there's nobody above him anymore. It's like he's really alone. There's nobody there. There's nobody above that level who's negative. And so then they're in a little bit of a quandary. And they actually then get some message from higher self that they interpret, because they're very close to the level of higher self. So they get the message from higher self that you are not separate from the consciousness you're manipulating. Who are you? What is the you separate from your action? And then they realize, aha, there is no separate I from the action on the apparently separate elements of mind or consciousness. And then they just dissolve into one, and then they go to the level of higher self, and then they're no longer negative, and they're beyond polarity. I don't know more details than that, but the resolution of the two paths in early 6D is akin to the unification of the spinal nerves around the spinal channel, that ends at the back of the medulla oblongata. Or the back side of the sixth chakra, third eye, is in physiology and yogic theory the point where the Ida and Pingala, the moon and sun, yin and yang, plus and minus, gold and silver, you know, positive and negative energy channels that weave around in a very double helix spiral way around the central canal. up the spine, up those spinal chakras, ends at the back of the head in the position behind sixth chakra. Medulla oblongata. But that's basically an analogy for the end of the two paths in mid-sixth density.
Interesting.
As above, so below. As within, so without.
You
know? So that's, to me, that's very interesting.
Yeah. Scott, do you want to take a little break and then we can go on, or are you okay to go on?
I'm okay. We have what we'll talk for another 40.
Yeah.
Okay.
What can, we obviously talk so much about Wanderers and the cosmology behind it. What can Wanderers do? And for people, most importantly, of course, for people listening now who haven't looked into all this material or just starting to look into this material, what would you recommend? How would you recommend they go about discovering this and practicing and discovering their mission, so on and so forth?
Well, if the person is wondering, am I a wanderer? Well, then it's a good thing to try to answer that question. The first thing to recognize is that the answer, you already know the answer. The answer is already quite clearly available in the deep mind. And so, if you want to know the answer, ask yourself. But it means ask yourself deeply and try to develop some faith in the fact that you know it already. But you forgot it, as well as you're not able to access it. You're not able to access it, and so you forgot it. That's part of the veil, no problem. But the answer is within you. What are the limits of the deep mind? Do you know? No, there are no limits to the deep mind. Because mind is not localized in the body. And there is such a thing as higher self. And we're multidimensional now. So the first thing is to develop a bit of self-trust and realize that the answer is in your heart. It's in your deep mind. And so with that knowing, one can meditate on it. One can pray a little and ask for help in seeing the truth. It's not to see that I am. It's to see what I am. To see what's true, not to confirm what I hope. Of course not. So the purpose is to confirm what's true, not to confirm your emotional bias. And so seek the truth. Seek it within and read and listen and talk to people and, of course, ask questions. I have an ET quiz, ET questionnaire, and then, people answer that. They get a score of 80 or something and they say, well, I think I am. And that just shows that, even you have a high score, which is associated with people who I would consider wanderers and consider themselves wanderers, and the profile fits, still that's not enough for them to be sure, of course. So, if you really want to be sure, then get sure. But realize that nobody can make you sure. It's a self-validating or self-affirming insight or realization. And beyond that, it's also fine to realize you don't know. I don't know. Maybe I can't find it. Maybe the answer is within, but I'm not that clear. Okay, fine. So in terms of life purpose, that's not, it's not required to be a wanderer, of course, to be a goodly or saintly person. It's not required to be a wanderer to be spiritual or to work and help the world. And you can do, in the end, it's, do whatever you want. But depending on what you value, what do you value? Well, if you value self-development and service to other, then do it. Meaning, they're considered three foundations on the spiritual path from a Western perspective. Study, meditation, and service, the three pillars. So jump into each, study, meditation, and service. But each must be carefully approached so you don't waste your time and fall in with foolish teachers. So study. Well, make sure that the source you're putting your time to and your attention and your care, make sure that it's mature and positive. Positive is not enough. There's a saying in Brazil, just because he's dead doesn't mean he knows anything. And that's to counter the naive spiritism of many love over wisdom folks there who think that any channeled message or any spirit communication must be absolute, you know, highest truth. This is completely wrong. First of all, lots of channeling comes from people's mind, channeled mind. And then there are both positive and negative spirits. And then there are both high and low positive spirits, or ET groups, elder and younger. So for me, I mean, I found some sources that I think are the real deal. The raw material, original Buddhism, the Theravadan in the Pali language, some yoga, Hinduism, Taoism, some theosophy, even though Alice Bailey is a mixed cat, some of theosophy, Joao Kuhl, I think is very helpful. Another source is Hilarion from Maurice Cook. Seth material, I think, has a lot of value, although it's so practical. So I just stay with the sources that I trust. And I know, for me, that they're the real deal. Because by using them, development occurs. Greater understanding and the greater capacity to listen and think and consider without dogmatism. So, I mean, I'm strongly believing what I believe, but I also know that I know very, very little. I know almost nothing compared to what can be known. So that's not a problem either. But study is central. And then there's meditation, and you have to make sure you have an authentic practice that goes all the way to enlightenment. And then service to other basically means engaging with others in any way you want that's of benefit to both of you.
Yeah.
Without infringing and forcing on them. So I think that the wanderers have to realize that if you don't know, you don't know. And if you feel like you don't like it here and you don't belong here, that's fine. And there may be, it may be because you're a wanderer. Fine. You may still have psychological issues like we all do. Fine. And, you know, this is a free will zone, so do whatever you want. But in the end, of doing what you believe in of necessity will be of benefit to you and others if it's truly embraces love and freedom for all. You know, negatives do what they want too. But if you value truth and goodness, then do whatever you want.
Right.
And, so and what you want will be good for you and for others, to the extent that you're aware of what it means.
Yeah. And obviously this term, this kind of little bucket that we've made of wanderers, I mean, at the end of the day, that's just a label. It doesn't matter if you realize or people realize, if wanderers realize that they are wanderers, as long as they're doing, you know, the service, as you're saying.
Well, do whatever you want. The question is, what's the purpose of your being here?
Right.
And that's not a matter of what you want. That's a matter of what's true and the mind you had before incarnation. So the mind that the originating source mind before incarnation is very available now. It ain't somewhere else. It ain't up there in the clouds. It's in your deep mind. So open the channels to communication from the conscious to the unconscious, and you'll know all you need to know. But the purpose of our being here is, you know, development of what we are. So Don asked Ra, what's the purpose of incarnation? And Ra said, the purpose of incarnation is the development of body, mind, spirit. Really simple. Right. And so the purpose of life is the development of all that you are. Totally simple. And there are two ways to do it, with love and without love. Most souls choose love. And so the wanderer, you don't have to be a wanderer to be goodly or to be helpful or to be virtuous or to fulfill your life purpose. But there's general and specific life purpose. So when we talk about life purpose, the first is, you know, develop what you are in a general way, which is to be free of blockages and to develop love wisdom. And then there's the specific, which is, well, what do you want to be? You want to do painting, you want to do childcare, you want to cook, you want to write books, you want to, you know, just learn on the internet 8 hours a day, you want to just walk around, you want to, what do you want to do? Whatever you want to do can be a goodly thing if you do it in a goodly way. And what you serve is what you are, not what you do. What you do is the carrier of what you are. What you are is the impelling force of what you do. But what's offered is what you are in a metaphysical way. And what's offered is your radiation of love light. And, Ra said something like, the best way to be of service to others is to freely share your understanding, your awareness of the law of one, which is basically the degree to which you know all is one. Yeah. I am another you in Lakesh. And just the sharing of what you are is the most authentic service. As to the specifics of role and position and profession and all that, fielder's choice, up to you.
Now, I just want to mention to people who are listening out there as well, there's an excellent, excellent book by Carla Ruckert, who was the channel for Ra, and she wrote a book called The Wanderer's Handbook. I'm not sure when this came out, but it's an excellent, excellent book. It's available for free, and it covers everything from Scott's questionnaire about, am I a wanderer? Talks about family and all this. I'm just looking at the chapters now. It's self-doubt, psychic greeting, it talks about the new age, it talks about sex, it talks about the energy system, it talks about the chakras, it talks about karma. lots of great information in here. It's about 500 pages plus. So I really recommend that to anybody who's listening to that, to us right now.
Right.
Now, I wanted to cover as well with you, Scott, this theme of getting, I guess, sucked into a light versus dark thing now. And we've talked about David Wilcock a little bit. Do you want to just maybe give some advice to people who are, I guess, into David's work and are looking into all the stuff that the 4D negative groups are doing? How do we approach that?
Well, I can just say how I approach it.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm not the guide of anybody, so okay. I'm just saying what I know and what I see. First of all, in some ways, David Wilcock became what he is today by a conversation he and I had in 95, 97, at a conference in Connecticut, which he references on his website. When I was already teaching from my first book from elsewhere, and he was a guy who hadn't yet found his mission. And I basically respected and recognized his light and his intelligence and his capacity. And I encouraged him strongly, honestly, do your thing, man. You have a lot to offer. You could do a great, great work. And that was enough for him to take the ball and run with it. And he was the first speaker of the science section in the Time of Global Shift and did really good work. And personally, I like him a lot. He's a brother. Intellectually, I'm very in disagreement with a lot of what he says. And it's not a personal dislike at all, but it's a very significant difference of opinion. So he wrote an article, Will 2012 Be the Year of Freedom? And this is the mainline view of imminent disclosure, the revelation of planetary evil and cosmic benevolence. And so he said, and I'll read sections if you don't mind.
Yeah, sure.
Literally dozens of dreams I've had predicting an imminent spectacular global event where financial tyranny is fully rooted out and exposed. Negative forces will most definitely be exposed on a mass level imminently. Exactly how imminent, I'm not certain, but it would definitely appear to be before the end of this year. Now, this was written in October, so we only have a few months left. Then he goes on, we will first see something that looks like a very scary economic collapse, but that we will come through it miraculously unscathed. The fear is much worse than what will actually happen. Apparently, from the higher perspective, the negative elite now have a mathematical certainty of defeat. In physical terms, they may have a few moves left to make, but these are very few, and regardless of the choices they make or the tricks they try to pull, the outcome will be the same. This outcome as I am now seeing it, is ridiculously positive. And there's a section called the Star Trek Age. He says, apparently, and this is the synopsis in a way, apparently we will see a full exposure of the bad stuff, which is financial tyranny and what's behind it, followed by, or in conjunction with, a remarkable disclosure with a capital D about all the other humans out there who've been visiting us throughout all of history to help us out, meaning positive ETs.
Mm-hmm.
Goes on. From that, a wealth of technologies that can heal our planet and throw us straight into the Star Trek age will suddenly show up as well. Things could get a little crazy for a few days, and it will all work out beautifully. Okay. Well, that's the bulk of the prediction. And you've basically got a number of things simultaneously. One is an imminent before the end of the year. He says it would definitely appear to be before the end of the year. So it's definitely possible. But that doesn't mean it'll happen. It just means, in his view, it's definitely apparent that it may happen. Imminent spectacular global event. That imminent spectacular event will be the definite exposure of negative forces on a mass level. Okay. Financial tyranny and the Illuminati, basically, and all the evil that's behind all that.
Mm-hmm.
So then that would be something related to a very scary economic collapse, but it'll be over in a few days and miraculously unscathed. The fear is worse. So there'll be an economic collapse, but it won't last long. Things could get crazy a few days, but it'll all work out beautifully because all the evil ones will be exposed. And then there will be a remarkable disclosure about all the positive ETs. Okay, and then from that, we'll have a wealth of new technologies in the Star Trek age, and things will become ridiculously positive.
Mm-hmm.
First of all, I can't really sit comfortably with anybody who puts the words together ridiculously positive, because positive is not ridiculous whatsoever. And if I ever say ridiculously positive, I think it means I don't understand positive. Positive is not ridiculous. And I'm not being nitpicking, actually. I'm saying what I see, which is some misunderstanding here. Now, the point is, who's going to expose all the evil? Where are all the good folks? In the military? In the media? In the secret finance? Where are they? Okay. So some kind of white hat group is going to announce all the evil ones, and all the evil ones will then, relinquish their power in a few days. And then there'll be this disclosure of the glorious positive ETs who will then give us all those technologies. Now, why? This is exactly the same as Sheldon Neidl's prediction, by the way, many years ago, which was that the ETs will come down, take away our evil leaders, take away our weapons, and after 3 days of darkness, we will have enlightened planetary government and the world will be ridiculously positive. So that, of course, didn't happen. And it's a pipe dream. You see, the point is, in my view, I don't see any positives who are in positions of authority to reveal the enormity of the negative forces on Earth. Number two, the Confederation would never do this. Never. They will never come down and root out negativity. Never. Because it's not their job. People have to experience the consequences of their choices, even when they're misguided and confused. And the other thing is that to a large extent, the negative power structure on Earth is the result of latent negativity in those who are oppressed. Meaning they want it. They don't want to be oppressed, but they support the power structure. They support conventional religion. And so it's a massive infringement to come down and say, your leaders are evil. Here are the new technologies which your evil leaders have repressed. And we will what? Lead you now? We will determine who's positive and we'll put them in power and throw out those who are negative? The Confederation? we'll do that? Give me a break.
It takes away our learning lessons, huh?
Were there no potentials for misunderstanding, there would be no potentials for understanding. Were there no misunderstanding, there's no potential to get out of it. And so karma is not has not been suspended in the last few years of the 3D cycle. The negatives have a right to be here. They have a right to be negative. And the people who are deluded have a right to continue being deluded. And those who are positive have a right to be protected and continue freely as much as they can too. Everybody has a right. And, you know, I'm not negative. I dislike them a lot. They were directly attacking me before. So I know what I'm not a shill and an apologist. Mm-hmm. What I'm saying is that the Confederation values non-infringement above the above some idea that it would be much better to live in paradise, which is true. They come because of the sorrow, but they don't come in a way that overrules the free will of humanity.
Right.
And you see, the only ones who could expose all the massive evil here is the Confederation. The only ones who will be, who could appear and who are truly positive is the Confederation. And they're not going to do it. It's just, you know, these are the last few years of 3D. And so they're going to come down and throw out all the evil ones. Why? Because they want us to live happily? No, that's not the game here. Just to take it easy and have a good time. That's not the purpose of creation. The purpose of incarnation is the development of mind, body, spirit. And those who create conditions of suffering need to learn how to get out of suffering. And an evil world system is unfortunately very much supported, including by the oppressed. Mm. Look at mainstream churches. Look at political parties. Look all over the world. Most people would like to join the elite, not that they detest the system. So in a world where most people actually accept that the system is okay, and really would just like to be at a higher position of power and have the morality where they can accept killing. They go off to war, you know, they go kill. They do a lot of harm here to each other. And so in a world like that, the positive ETs are going to come down and take over. It's basically taking over.
Yeah.
Right? That's not going to happen. It doesn't work like that. So then who's running David? Who's behind this? Who's behind it would be those who would benefit from a fake disclosure and a fake cleansing. The fake cleansing and the fake disclosure. And whoever would benefit are those who want the New World Order. There are those who want to who would benefit. Cui bono. Those who benefit from this are those who are making it up. I'm not saying David is Illuminati. I'm just saying that this whole thing serves the ends of those who would be the masters of the earth.
So you're saying that David Wilcock is tainted by 4D negative?
Well, not specifically. Anybody who's imperfect has some 4D negative influence, myself included. Everybody, right? If you're not a saint, I mean, even Yeshua and the Buddha were approached by Maya and Mara and Satan, you know, before their final breakthrough.
Mm-hmm.
So even at such a high level of development, negativity is present or has some influence. So I'm not saying that, really. What I'm just saying is this scenario, which is to me completely fraudulent and in violation of the cosmic law of free will, is supportive of those who would benefit from a fake disclosure and a fake cleansing who would then take over power. And if people are interested, look at Project Bluebeam. Mm-hmm. The guy's name is Serge Monast, S-E-R-G-E Monast, M-O-N-A-S-T. Look at the work of Vladimir Trzezinski. There are many people who, Phil Schneider, Dean Warwick, look at the words of people who, you know, talked about a fake alien disclosure and the fake takeover of, you know, cleansing of the banking system to be replaced by, you know, military dictatorship. So unfortunately, this type of narrative supports that, because it's completely impossible given the law of free will. And you know, maybe I'm wrong, but I don't think so. If I'm wrong, please show me. But I'm simply telling it like I see it, which is that given my understanding of the law of free will and the historical trend, the historical dynamics of the Confederation, which is non-intervention or non-upsetting intervention behind the scenes, you know, like crop circles. Crop circles are the way they were, which is beauty and mystery and great precision, and they don't even hurt the crops. And people are left on their own to decide what it is.
So you're saying that crop circles are made by the Confederation?
In my view, majority are, for sure.
Mm.
Oh, and by the way, I wanted to read. You see, some things that David said are right, and I agree totally.
Mm-hmm.
He said, from a higher perspective, negative elite have a mathematical certainty of defeat. If you understand that in fourth density, the negatives will not be here, then that's right. From my view, which is some idea about the higher perspective, the negative elite have absolutely no chance of being on Earth in the fourth density positive cycle. They'll wait till 3D begins here again, which it will, according to Ra. But it's not that they've been defeated. It's simply they've been relocated. And they're prohibited from being in a 4D positive world because you can't take the light. Because you can't, you know, you can't get in there unless you can vibrate in harmony with qualities of love. So then it won't be there. That's true. And I'm sure they know it. Certainly Orion, that drives the Illuminati, knows it. But that's fine. The thing I just, and then he said also, I was shown very clearly in dreams that it's absolutely useless and destructive to choose the path of control, meaning service to self, for any reason, unless you fully and completely intend to become a sociopathic mass murderer. That's absolutely true. Because if you don't wish to consciously, not by mind control, but consciously become a sociopathic mass murderer, a la Genghis Khan, a la Taras Bulba, a la Rasputin, if you're not into becoming that, then you should get off the path, the negative path, because that's where you're going to have to go if you're going to continue. And then there's a crop circle. There was a crop circle message from, I don't know, 2008, 2006, 2010. And this one was considered maybe a response to some human coded message sent out.
I think I saw that. Yeah.
Yeah, you know that. The message is very important. And that's another reason why I would say crop circles are made by the Confederation. The message is, quote, beware the bearers of false gifts and their broken promises. Much pain, but still time. Believe there is good out there. We oppose deception. Conduit closing. Now, it's just up to each to consider who are the bearers of false gifts, who are the bearers of broken promises. I'm not saying David. I'm just saying those that are negative. Beware the I'm not saying David at all. I'm saying, but I do believe what he's saying is untrue, meaning metaphysically impossible. But beware the bearers of false gifts and their broken promises.
Yeah.
So people should consider who are the bearers of false gifts. Much pain. Yeah, a lot of pain on planet Earth, but still time. Dimensional shift hasn't happened yet. Believe there is good out there. Yeah, the cosmos is a glorious, beautiful place. Infinite love. Really, no joke. And we oppose deception, and so do I. and so does anybody who seeks truth. Oppose deception. No need to bring the Confederation and root out evil. They're not allowed. They wouldn't want to take away our opportunity to grow. And they also wouldn't want to go against those who actually want the system as it is. Even though they don't like, even though they're on the bottom oppressed, they actually believe in the system. This is a very subtle, deep point. In general, even those underfoot, the bottom levels of the society everywhere, globally, more or less simply wish they were at a higher level. Not that they don't want, that they oppose the hierarchical money system. Not. And that's a very profound reason why the Confederation would not take it away from them, in my view.
Yeah, I just wanted to make a comment about Bluebeam and this alien invasion scenario. I thought it was very interesting over the last kind of 2 years that we've seen so many negative, like, whenever there's an alien movie, it's always about invasion. I'm like always thinking, what about peace and harmony? What happened to like Carl Sagan's Contact? You know, like, why so much negativity about extraterrestrials? Yeah, it's real.
Because who runs Hollywood?
Mm.
Who runs Hollywood is basically the people that David considers, you know, financial tyranny or the Illuminati or the negatives.
Yeah.
I mean, everywhere. It's not Hollywood only. It's everywhere. You know?
Yeah.
So the Matrix is, you know, you can see it when you turn on your TV and when you look out your window, said Morpheus. So the reason that there's a slant towards negative ETs probably is related to the preconditioning for Project Bluebeam if they're going to do it. And yeah. Bluebeam would involve a false positive and then a false negative and then a false positive. The false negative is the false either, you know, disclosure of the fall of negative ETs who are really not negative ETs or some kind of War of the Worlds, you know, mass UFO invasion globally, which would be done, which would be a drama made by human technology.
Mm-hmm.
And then the bringing in of the false positive, which is genuine or fake positive ET who are really negative ET. The presentation of supposedly benevolent ETs who are really negative ETs or not even ETs by the same forces that will then tell you that you've got to do this and that to save the world or to create the glorious new world.
Right.
These are all false gifts and broken promises.
Yeah. Problem, so, reaction, solution.
Right. So if there's a disclosure, you know, hold on to your hat, because then we're entering a phase of very significant social conflict in disagreement. Some people, you know, will say yes, and other people will fight to the death to say no. And so that if there's a disclosure, then you better be stable, because it'll be really messy at that point. And you know, the question will be, how can you believe the human authority? How can you trust human authority? After all this, you still trust human authority? Then you're a fool. Not you, but it's foolish. After millennia, really, or at least decades, of deceptive, violent human leadership, to trust anything they say. This is a no-brainer, I think. But you see, people act like children, so they project the leadership as parents.
Yeah.
They don't want to go against their parents.
So what kind of government do you envision in 4D?
It'll be a governance of the most sanctified, the humblest and most developed in love and no self and unconditional acceptance and unconditional, you know, living of truth. They'll be those who will be, you know, in positions of governance.
Mm.
It'll be basically governance by virtue. Those who are greater developed in virtue and love and wisdom will be those at the top, just as in any true, you know, ashram. you know, there are some, there have been some, and the guru or the teacher is simply recognized by all to be the guy who's done the most work. And he would never do anything to hurt anybody, and there's power is not centralized. And there's no autocracy, and it's win-win only. If it isn't win-win, it doesn't happen. So it'll be, you know, leadership. There's probably a term for it, but I don't know what. It's, you know, meritocracy, sort of, but it's not about merit. It's about goodness. It's a virtuocracy. Those who are of greater virtue will be, will everybody will want him to be in leadership. Just like, you know, you want the Buddha to be your teacher, not some guy off the street. You want somebody who really has purified mind to be in the position of making decisions. And therefore, they would be the most selfless and the most humble, the most non-greedy, the most free of ignorance and greed.
Which is almost like a bit, I guess, you know, we talk about democracy a lot. And in some ways, this runs counter to this thinking that if everybody had a say, it would be the best solution. But very often, people don't have a clue. They're just children, and you don't let children run the show.
Yeah, well, I don't know politics so well, but I believe Marx or one of these guys said something like democracy is a step on the way to world socialism. And so it's there's also the term demos is sometimes translated as mob, M-O-B. So it's mob rule, or maybe that's a loose translation of the Greek, but you see, the problem is that we're in 3D, and 3D, by nature, is freely given to 3D souls, who are positive, negative, and not yet either. That's what 3D is. And Ra said that in the galaxy, 60% of the 3D planets, the 3D inhabited races, planets, 60% are all positive or positive harvest. 30% are mixed and 10% are service to self negative. So then 60% of the 3D planets, you know, at a level similar to humans on Earth, are all positive, pretty much. That's the norm, but it's only 60%. 30%, which is a third and not such a small number, are mixed like Earth. But most of the harvest is positive. And then 10% are negative. But given the fact that 3D souls have the right to choose positive, negative, or nothing, the poor will always be with us. Meaning, those who are unclear deserve to have 3D. And if they are manipulated to become slaves of a negative system, what the positives can do is limited to pull them out of what they've chosen and maintain. I mean, sad to say, but the positives confederation follows strictly respect for free will.
Yeah.
So, but I would just say that, Earth, if you understand Earth's role in this sector of the galaxy, you'll understand why we have this mix of souls and why the negative leadership. 3D repeaters make a kind of messy situation. And that's what we've got here. And that's why Wanderers are here. Because the 98% 3D native population, most of whom are unpolarized, meaning they're not really positive or negative. They're somewhat positive, but not harvestable. Not going to graduate, because of that 98% that really is unclear about its path, Wanderers come here. And so Don asked Ra about nuclear disarmament, and Ra, of course, they're positive. They don't want nuclear war, but they didn't say you should disarm. They said, rather than your toys needing dismembering, your peoples need orientation. And so when the peoples have orientation, then, you know, the bad stuff is exposed. The bad stuff doesn't grow.
Yeah.
So it's just the same as taking care of your body. Take good care of your body and you won't have gangrenous legs.
Yeah.
You know? So take good care of yourself and you'll be living your life purpose, actually. Because naturally you'll want to be goodly to others and naturally you'll be listening to your soul, your heart, and finding what's best for you. And it will be also beneficial to others because you don't want to hurt others. That's not our way. And if you can't find others that are fitting, then stand alone.
Amen.
Amen.
Scott, it's been a tremendous conversation. Certainly one of the longest interviews I've done, but so much good content in here.
Yeah, thank you for the opportunity.
With this material, we can really go on, can't we? I mean, there's so many other things that I would love to talk to you about, and I would love to follow up with you with another session.
Sure, we can do that.
But I think we'll wrap this one up for now.
It's a long one.
We're kind of pushing the boundaries every time. The next one will be 3 hours.
Let's keep it at 2 hours, all right? I'm okay, but
yeah.
I need a break too.
Yeah. Okay, Scott, thank you so much.